church. It's wonderful to be together with everyone this morning. All right. Get all set up here. It was so cool when it wasn't cool that we were set to be with AMS and the building got messed up and it didn't get booked properly. So there was actually a room got booked that would only seat AMS with 50 people, not us. But what was really cool about it is when I sent the text messages out to that we were going to be with Central, all the Southland people were like, yeah, I can't wait to be. I love going to Pasadena and being together. And so it's great to see that our two regions love being together. And certainly I had a phenomenal time with all of you last Sunday. Thank you for all your kind comments about the lesson. I've gotten a lot of feedback over the week about the struggle is real. And yet today I want to try and take it a little higher, amen? And I really wrestled over the title of today's lesson. I thought about making the title Fire and Brimstone. And so I would hear that, but that would have been for me, so that wouldn't have, I had to change it up. Today we're going to talk about fire from the Lord. And what the role of fire is in the Bible. It's a fascinating study. Mike stole my intro in his welcome, which was pretty cool. It's pretty awesome when you know you go, amen. I can't say all that now, but it's great to see we're all on the same page. And so with that, you can be turning in your Bibles to Judges chapter 6. Judges chapter 6. So, after wrestling and wrestling with what should I have the title of today's lesson be, I finally came to a decision, and the title of today's lesson is hashtag fire. Oh! Hashtag fire. And of course, we came up when we were in Mexico City a few weeks ago at the conference, a bunch of us sitting at the table decided, okay, it's time to put a hashtag out about evangelism. And we talked and talked, and it was a great thing. About 20 of us sitting at a table said, we need a cool acronym. And of course, there's nothing like the study of fire in the Bible. And so we came up with fire, like Mike said in the welcome, faithful in radical evangelism. Amen? And of course it got really quiet because we're not all evangelizing kind of the way that we need to right now. And I very rarely, I want you to know today is an exception to the rule. I typically don't preach about evangelism. What I endeavor to do is help you be so grateful for your salvation, to help you to understand what God has done for you in your life, giving you the pearl of the kingdom right before your eyes, or letting you be a part of God's kingdom that you can't help but tell everybody about it. And so I don't talk about it very much. I talk about being grateful for your salvation. And yet today I feel the need to talk about evangelism. Amen? And so we've been talking about being grateful for your salvation for a long time, and yet there's still bitternesses and different things that are going in. Today I want you to mark down in your calendar. Today's the day that the Crew Super Region turns the corner and starts taking this city for Jesus. Amen? So, let's talk about fire from the Lord for a little bit here. You know, last Sunday was incredible. We had a blow-away worship service here. It was great to see that we had three people baptized in the Lord last week. That was awesome. And yet, throughout all of LA, we had 19 people added to our congregation last Sunday. Is that not incredible? 16 people gained salvation. 16 people, for the very first time, from the truth of John 3, got to see the kingdom for the first time. Because you can't even see it till you're born of water and of spirit. And yet, we're going to rest on the topic of fire today. You know, in Exodus 3, the Bible says that God revealed himself to Moses through fire. It's pretty awesome. I don't know about you, but to go up on a mountaintop to spend time with God and you're sitting there and this big bush in front of you just lights on fire. And yet the Bible says that that God revealed himself in fire there, the bush was on fire, but it wasn't burning.
Wow.
And there's just something intriguing about God with fire.
Yeah.
There's something just inspiring about it, that God can set you on fire, but you're not burning up. You know what I'm saying? He can set things on fire and they don't burn up.
Yeah.
And yet, if they do burn up, it means something that we're going to talk about today.
Come on, bro.
And so, but yeah, right there, God was calling Moses for years to be his leader.
Come on.
And yet Moses ran from it. I know I don't have anybody in here running from leadership or anything like that. But that's the principle of Exodus 3, is that there are people that should be leading who aren't, who are capable of leading, who are not, and making all kinds of excuses. And let me just tell you, one day, you're going to run into your burning bush.
Yep. Come on, bro. Amen.
And the bush is going to be on fire, and you're going to be like, oh, get some water! And you're going to realize, wait a minute, it's not burning up. This is God revealing himself to me. And so God revealed himself to Moses through fire. And then Moses accepted who God made him to be. See, Moses had not accepted his destiny and who God had called him to be. And yet then over in Judges, Gideon struggled with his calling.
Yeah. Come on, bro.
And so Gideon was like, God approaches him and says, hey, mighty warrior. And Gideon's like, are you kidding me? Have you seen me? Have you seen my family? Have you seen my village? I'm in a wine press. Now, it's funny. He says he was in a wine press threshing. So, if for those of you who may not know what threshing is, it's separating wheat, right? The grains of wheat from the stalk. And so, you have what's like a pitchfork, and you have to get it up over your head, and you're shaking it all out. And you're separating. Well, the wine presses back then were like this tall. And they were tiny. And he was hiding from all the enemies of God. He was hiding from all of his enemies. It's like when we hide in our homes. And we hide and we hide right next to Netflix. You know? And so, I can say that. I've been there too. You know? So I'm not like looking down on you. We all get to that place. And so he's in this little dinky place and he's like threshing. You know, we do these stupid things in our lives where we're like, what are you doing? Why? Go outside where you're supposed to do threshing. Get out there and do it the right way. But we get so full of fear in our lives. And yet, God uses his fire to get rid of our fears. And so... But Gideon was really stubborn. So he's like, I don't really believe it's you, God. I think you got some, this is another spirit maybe or something. So I'm going to take this fleece and I'm going to put it out there and I'm going to test you. See if you're really calling me. And so Gideon makes himself a nice altar. And he makes his altar. And you know what the altar represents for us nowadays? Our ministry life. Our life and our ministry. And so he makes his altar, and then he starts putting his sacrifices on the altar. But then what he does is he starts praying. At least he had enough sense that he started praying. Okay, show me for sure. And so he does the prayer, and the Bible says that the fire of God comes on down, consumes the offering. And he goes, that was an angel. God, you are calling me. And he got his answer of who he was supposed to be in his life. I fear that many of us here are just attending church, not realizing who God called us to be, who he made us to be, not understanding the things he needs us to do, and the people in this world that need us. They don't need anybody else, they need you. Because you're the only one that can speak God's words in the way that they can hear, so that they will come to you. And yet, Gideon got his answer. Moses got their answer. And then they went out and they flat preached the word and led God's people and defeated the enemies of God like men who were truly sent by God. The Bible also says that when his people were in a great plague and David was their king, that David had a prayer to stop the plague. You ever had your ministry just tank for like a long time? Things are just not going well. You don't like anybody in your Bible talk. You want a new discipler, and everything's the result of the people around you, not you. I've been there too, you know. I think I was there for a few years at one point. And yet, he says his prayer, but you know, they didn't just say prayers. And I think this is a concept that I want us to walk away from today. What David did is he went and he built an altar. Wow. See, in the Old Testament, they had to build physically their altars. And that represents us building our ministries that we're a part of.
Come on, bro. That's right.
And we build the altar, and then we put our offering on the altar.
Amen.
And we offer our time.
Yeah.
We offer our heart.
Yep.
In fact, we don't withhold our heart. We offer our heart to each other.
Come on.
We share openly and really and transparent with people who are not even safe because God is our protector. And David made his altar, and he put his offering, and he prayed to God. And the Bible says the fire of God came down, and it consumed the offering. And I learned something that I never understood about the offering. And that was that the offering, when it, you know, I knew that when it gets burned up, it goes up, and it's a nice aroma to the Lord, the Bible says. And yet there's other offerings that are burnt up, but God doesn't accept them. And yet David was a righteous king with a righteous heart, wanting what God wanted. So when he prayed, the offering was consumed up, and the aroma went up to God, and the plague stopped.
Wow.
You know, at any moment in time, if you don't like your group, you can make your altar, put your offering, pray to the Lord, and the plague you perceive is happening will stop. Just like that. You don't need your leader to change. You don't need the people around you to change. You can pray to your God, who's your protector, and it'll all change because of your prayers. Well, doggone it, if God's people aren't stubborn, they just keep getting into problems. And in the time of Solomon, the Bible says that they were having challenges. So Solomon also made an altar, put his offering, prayed to God, and the fire of God came down, consumed the offering. The Bible says right there that the fire just filled the whole temple with his glory. Because within the fire of God comes the Spirit of God, and his glory is shown through the fire that we bring into this world.
Amen.
Are you on fire today?
Come on,
are you fired up today?
Come on,
are you ready to bring the fire of God down in your life today? It's your choice. You can be lukewarm, you can be cold, or you can build an altar. You can put some offerings in there, and you can pray to your God, and you can watch the fire of God come down from your prayers. You know, but then there's people who bring offerings. You know, and didn't Austin do a phenomenal job today? And I love that he discussed the offering of Cain versus Abel. And yet there, the offering that was given like Cain, Cain's not the only one that does that.
Yeah.
And in Leviticus 10, Aaron the priest, his sons, brought what the Bible calls unauthorized fire.
Yeah. Amen.
And so they're like, I'm giving my offering, but they were faking the funk. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, the person that comes in, they're like, hey, and they're in all kinds of sin. I was hiding it all. And they came in and they brought their unauthorized fire. And so they tried to light their altar. And yet the Bible says that, yes, the fire of God consumed their offering, but it consumed them right after. And I learned something, that God consumes all offerings, but he only accepts some. And he burns the rest along with the person that gives it. I guess that was the fire and brimstone part. I guess I went there still, but. But in Numbers chapter 11, here's the one that probably applies most to us Americans, right? I'm going to make this an American thing. So it ain't a black thing, it ain't a white thing, it's an American thing, right? Because we got fast food and remote controls and we got instant messaging, not delayed messaging, it's always instant with us. And so we lack patience. And so when we don't get what we want, when we want, how we want, in the way that it should, in our perspective, want it, then we get an attitude. Well, Numbers 11, the people had an attitude, right? So Moses struggled to accept his calling, right? Yeah. So he struggles to accept it. He finally gets it. So he says, I'm leading God's people. And then he starts leading, and what happens? They hate him. Go figure. Just a little tidbit. The more you reject your calling, the more your people will rebel because they hate you for not obeying God.
Wow.
And when you take over, you pay the price for all of that. And yet Moses was paying the price. And what's the price? The people complained. The Bible says in Numbers 11, the people complain because of their hardships, the Bible said. Anybody have some hardships?
Come on,
yeah? Well, the real question is, are you complaining about your hardships? That's the real question, right?
Come on, bro.
I never complain about mine, by the way, but just kidding. I don't know, the struggle's real. For sure. Struggle is real. I also appreciated Noel today.
Come on.
You did such a phenomenal job here. And yet, I don't know if you could imagine the wrestle and the struggle to want your family members to be disciples so badly. And you get your son, but not your mom and dad. You know? Wow. It's just, wow. For me, I got my dad. And then he fell away. He walked away from God. And yet, to me, it was actually harder than when he didn't know God. That he knew the truth and rejected it. My other son, Devin, he rejected it and walked away. There's nothing harder than that. And yet, I appreciated what Noel shared today. It was so powerful. It was so relevant. He was a little black, but, you know, amen, he's black. What do you expect? Black History Month, black man up here. What do you expect? So, struggle's real. But I appreciate that our church is very real.
That's right.
And honest and transparent. I know most of your lives to a degree. I don't know anyone that's given like Noel gives. He gives in silent. He gives in secret. He gives out of deep conviction. You know, it's interesting. I asked him to do today, earlier in the week, and he never got the text. So he found out in the circle right before we started service.
Wow.
That's his heart.
Wow.
That's, you just got his heart today.
Wow.
And that's the kind of people we have in this church.
Yeah.
It's an amazing thing.
Yes.
I mean, you think about it. Look around the room here. You got Don Pitts standing over there. You got the two head ushers there. You got Keontae on the camera.
Yep.
You got the sisters manning the Women's Day table back there.
Yeah.
Our sound guys. You got Ricky back there. You should take a seat, brother. There's extra ones. It's okay. You don't have to sit on the floor. You got Tio, and you got all of our ushers. All these people serve us every day. And then we leave. We come in. We sit down. We set our spot and don't invade my space, you know. There's some of you have extra space around you. But let's see what happens. We leave our stuff. So we come and worship God, and then we leave our filth and trash behind, and these guys pick it up. So just for us in Southland, when we get our new building, we can't do that. You leave nothing behind. All right? It doesn't honor God to have somebody serve you and pick up your trash. And yet, what Noel shared really hit me. When he talked about people that benefit from everything and then complain. I was like, wow. Whoa, it ministered to me. Most of you have no idea what it took just to start this church.
Come on, bro.
And I mean, for me, I gave up my retirement. I had a church that fell apart, a church of over 10,000 people. And it was a mess. And so I lost my church, so I gave up my life to restart it. And we had death threats, all kinds of garbage going on. And so I found myself, if I'm real and honest, getting an attitude about the attitudes.
Wow.
There was a thing in me that was like, how could you be so ungrateful when you have no idea what it took to build this thing?
Right.
The lives that were sacrificed, the friends that were lost, the things that went into all of it, the attacking.
Yep.
And I just want to apologize to all of you that I've had that sitting in there. And Noel, thank you for drawing that out of me. You ministered to me today. So, and when a minister gets an attitude, there's an edge that comes out in certain areas of his preaching. And if anything about talking about attitudes, I've offended you or hurt you in undue way, I apologize. So I don't want that edge to be on my preaching. So I believe in being respectful and honest and kind and teach fervently and accurately, but to teach God's word, not my word. And so, amen. But in Numbers 11, the Bible says, and see, now I can talk about complaining properly, right? You watch out now, right? So the Bible says that they complained about their hardships. This is what we do in America. We complain about perceived hardships, like Noel said. We didn't get to go to the movies. I didn't get my Starbucks. How could you ask me to not get my Starbucks? Yeah, and so we complain about our hardships. Why do we complain? Because we don't understand fire. See, the Bible says that when they complained about their hardships, you go, well, maybe some of them were real hardships. Guess what? They were. They were real sharp hardships. They were right about what they were saying, but God's anger is aroused in grumbling and complaining.
Wow.
No matter what, his anger gets aroused. And so what does that do? The Bible says that fire from the Lord came down and burned the outskirts of their camps.
Wow.
So what does God do? You go, I have all these hardships. Doggone it, why do I have this hardship? Ah! And then fire comes down. And what's the camps? Your life. And so your life gets harder, and then you have a choice, complain more or get grateful that you have a camp. And so what we do is we complain more, and then there's more fire, and we go, it's my leader's fault. See, that's what they did. They blame Moses. You're leading us to our death, they said. Our women and children, they're going to be taken as plunder. Had they been taken as plunder? No. We're going to die in the desert. Like, the dude made water come out of a rock. And they're scared they're going to die in the desert, you know? Yeah, we want something to eat. Manna. No, we want meat to eat. At every point, no matter what was done, it wasn't good enough. And yet, we get angry because we don't realize that God's going to bring fire and mess our life up more. And so we complain. Instead of beg to be saved.
Come on. Yeah, that's right.
What did that produce? In Numbers 16, all the complaining, what complaining does is complaining rallies.
Yeah.
It gathers.
Yeah.
So we're supposed to be gathering disciples, but we can oftentimes gather the wrong way. We gather with our complaint.
That's right.
And we feel awesome because everybody around us is complaining about the same thing.
Wow.
So we go, see, I'm right. And nobody cares if you're right. God doesn't care if you're right. All he cares about is if there's complaining.
Wow.
So what they did is they gathered. Who did they gather? The Bible says 250 community leaders.
Yeah.
So that would be like all of our house church leaders in the church. And got all the house church leaders in the whole place like complaining about Moses.
Wow.
And so God does not turn a blind eye. So what God did is the Bible says that fire from the Lord came down and consumed them. Then the ground opened up, swallowed them, boom, all complaining stopped. See, me as the leader, I don't have to do anything about your complaining. Because your complaining destroys you already. So I don't have to get in there. I just have to watch you die. And so that's the thing about the complaining. See, and I'm trying to save you from dying. That's my role. See, the Bible says Moses went, when he got rid of his attitude, right? And he went face down. And he prayed. And the fires died down. That's what your leaders do for you. They're imperfect. Sometimes disorganized. Sometimes overzealous. But we love you. God chose us to lead you. We didn't choose it. Once you get into it, you go, wow, if I knew there was all this complaining, oh my gosh. And then you go into your wine press. And then God burns the outskirts of your wine press because you're complaining in your heart. And so God burned up the problem and got rid of it. Well, then, probably the most famous scripture about fire is in 1 Kings 18. And in those days, the people worshiped, like with all their heart. And yet, they were worshiping Molech. They were worshiping Baal. Here's what worshiping Baal and Molech looked like. It looked like partying, a lot of music and dancing, having sex with each other, and doing drugs. That's what worshiping Baal and Molech looks like. And so the people were, they were worshiping with all their heart, because it was fun. It was fun. And Elijah couldn't take it anymore. And he said, bring all the prophets of Baal here. And bring all those other prophets. 850 of them. And you know what Elijah did, right? Elijah built an altar. So he built his altar. And he said, all right, I'm going to put all the offering down. Kind of like what we're supposed to do every week, right? You all think I'm talking about money. I'm talking about your time, your heart, and your money. I'm talking about it all. So he puts the offering on the altar. And then he says, all right, guys, call on your God. Call on your God to bring fire from heaven and accept the offering. From morning till night, they beg. They dance. They're dancing around their Asherah poles, all their stuff, begging and pleading, and no answer from their gods. So what power you got in your life? What power do you have? And you know what? And you know what? We think, like, we talk about being disrespectful, but you know what Elijah did all day? He taunted them all day long. Where's your God? Scream louder! Louder! Where's he at? We'd think that disrespectful today. I don't really engage in that kind of thing very often, but the Bible says there's a time and place for everything. Where false doctrine reigns, it needs to be dealt with. You say, oh, I don't need to forgive. Okay. False doctrine.
Come on, bro.
That's true.
False doctrine can start without throughout the church.
Yeah.
So morning till, can you imagine from morning till evening, these prophets calling on their God with no answer?
Wow.
So then Elijah goes, I'm going to up it. And he covers everything in water. Puts water all over everything. He just soaks it. Where there's no way it's going to get light on fire. It says that he cut around the ground and he put water everywhere. He's like, all right, you guys done? My turn. My turn. Wasn't that he's a prophet? He said he's a follower of God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Follower of God. And when a follower of God, when it's their time to speak,
oh, yeah.
Oh baby, it's on. And so Elijah goes and he just calls down on God, answer my prayers, and the fire of the Lord. I can just imagine how God is, right? Just a little bit. And then just. Go on, bring it, yeah.
Come on, bro.
It just like burns up the offering. Like, yes. I told you so. See, told you, baby. My God.
Come on, bro.
But then the fire just kept getting bigger. And it burned up the offering. But then all the wood, it burned it all up. And then it's like stone. Okay, it's done. No, then the stone starts burning. And the altar catches fire, and the altar starts disintegrating. And it burned up the offering, the altar. It says the soil under the ground burnt up from the fire of God, and it consumed all 850 prophets. Oh, false doctrine, done.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Hashtag fire. That's the, that is the God that you serve. Right there.
That's fire, bro.
That's fire.
That is fire. Come
on. Then, you know, sometimes we get a little arrogant, so then what happened is they all came after him, so he ran for days. He forgot the God that he was following right after the greatest miracle of fire in the Bible. How about that? That's just who we are as people. I have 2 points for us today. Oh, you thought I was winding it down. That was the intro. That was the intro.
That's fire, bro.
Go to 1 Peter 3. I mean, 1 Peter 1. I just told you the story of Judges 6. Just go read it. 1 Peter 1, 3. We all have a wedding to go to as well, so I got to be timely here. First Peter 1, verse 3.
Come on, bro.
My 2 points are very simple. Our new hashtag is faithful and radical evangelism. So my 2 points go in line with that. First point, be faithful.
Amen. Come on, bro.
Be faithful. Our second point will be get radical. We'll get there in a moment. First Peter chapter 1, verse 3. In order to be faithful, you have to have faith. It's actually part of the word, is it not? In verse 3, the Bible says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy," we do not feel that enough. We do not let that sink in enough. God's great mercy on you. We think so much about the mercy that needs to be shown to those who hurt us that we don't think about the mercy that we need.
Wow.
In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope. Your life as a disciple of Jesus is a living hope.
Wow.
Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Into an inheritance. Now, check this out if you got a pretty good deal here with your salvation. Into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. Wow.
That's awesome.
When you're not happy, it's not God's problem. You have an inheritance that can't perish. It can't spoil. It can't fade. It's not tarnished. It's not down. It's not sad. It's kept up in heaven for you. Like we talked about last week, heaven will never be on earth no matter how much you try and build it. It is kept up there with him in perfection so that you'll strive to get there. It says, in this you greatly rejoice.
Yeah.
We rejoice about far too many things that are not this.
Whoa, bro.
We get far too caught up in other things that are not our salvation. That are not the salvation of others. Two things in life that should make us most happy. I'm saved and watching someone else get there. Nothing else. You know, this morning we were coming to church and I asked my son Dylan, "What'd you read today?" And he said that he had read Matthew chapter 3 and 4 about the baptism of Jesus. And he said it was so, he goes, "Dad, it was just like, wow." He said, Jesus got baptized and he came up out of the water and God said, "This is my son. With him, I'm well pleased." He said, "I realized, like, He's the only person on the face of the earth that God's pleased with, and he had to die because of me.
Wow.
Whoa. All right, let's turn around. We don't need to go to church today. I'm all good. I'm good, baby. Let's go save this world.
I'm good.
You know? I was like, wow, my kid's a disciple. He loves God, but he's grateful for his salvation. In this, you greatly rejoice. But here it comes. Though now for a little while, see, you think it's forever. When's this gonna end? Though now for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. And you go, why is this happening to me? I can't believe of all 8 billion people on the planet, this is happening to me. Right? That's where we get, right?
Yeah.
And what do we ask? Why?
Yeah. Yeah.
Why'd she say that? Why'd he do that? Why is this happening? You're actually supposed to have the answer to that already. That's the thing. Yeah. It amazes me how many people I speak with, and they're troubled, and they have hardship, and you go, why is God doing it? They go, I don't know. That's why it's going to keep happening, because you don't know. In fact, it keeps happening until you figure it out and let it change you, then it stops. So, that's all explained in Hebrews chapter 12, by the way. So you go, well, what's the answer? Verse 7. Huh, here it is. It's so plain. These have come so that your faith. See, God's, what's God going for? Faithful. Right? So that your faith, and now, oh, wow, look at how it describes it. How precious is this faith? Of greater worth than gold.
Come on.
You go, I ain't got any gold. So. But it says something about our faith here that I think we just goes, whoosh. You read something just like go over your head, you don't get the joke, you're like, huh?
Yeah.
Huh? I don't get it.
Yeah.
It says, these have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes.
Wow.
Death. Gone. See, Jesus died and was resurrected. We think that we're baptized and we die and we're resurrected and that's it. When in fact, your faith has to die again and again and again and again. Because our faith must be perfect. Our actions must not, but our faith must be. And in order for us to get there, God has to kill our faith. Because it won't get us to heaven in that place. Kill it. Refine it so that we can be reborn again in our faith better than ever before. It says, these have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, with which perishes, even though refined by what? Fire. May be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Everywhere you get an attitude, Jesus Christ is not revealed in your life. Everywhere you give in to sin consistently, Jesus Christ is not revealed in your life. Every challenge that makes you pull back and hide in your wine press threshing wheat, Jesus Christ is not revealed. So God's got to kill that faith. Annihilate it. Eliminate it. Wipe it from the face of the earth. And have you born from the ashes. Like an aroma going to God. Better than ever before. And it says, though you have not seen him, you love him. That's why you're here today.
Yeah.
And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him. And you're filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, something you cannot keep to yourself. You cannot hide in a wine press. You've got to give to the world because it saved you from you. If you're silent, you've forgotten it. If you're timid with it, you've forgotten it. It's an inexpressible and glorious joy. It's an overflowing that you cannot control. It's a wildfire inside of you. Why? for you're receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. There should be nothing else on this planet that makes you more fired up than that right there. And see, we don't get it, because that was like the weakest applause of all the things we've said, and that was when I told you you were saved. You see what I mean? That's where we've got to understand what God has given us. Don't feel guilty you haven't understood it. Just get it and get on about it. You know what I'm saying? We've got to be faithful. Go to John chapter 15. John chapter 15.
Amen. Come on, bro.
Come on, Ron.
Come on, bro. Great stuff, bro.
Verse 1.
Come on, bro. Bring the fire. Come on, bro.
The vine and the branches. God says, I am the true vine. Well, Jesus says. And my Father is the gardener. Now, check this off. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. While every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes. Wow. Why? Pain, suffering? So it will be more fruitful. See, that trial to your faith that killed it? No, it didn't kill. It cut off what was unfaithful and got rid of it. And many of us think that's awesome. Some of you should have learned that in your own private times reading your Bible. Some of you don't read your Bible and you say you're faithful and you're not. Disciples of Jesus read their Bibles every day. They check on what their preachers say. You see what I mean? And they stay in a relationship with God. That's what it means to be faithful. I'm glad it fires you up. Fire yourself up in the morning with reading it yourself. It says in verse 3, you're already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Man, it stinks to be a disciple and not feel saved. That's the worst life ever. It's shocking how many disciples don't feel saved. It's sad. You have the fire of God inside of you. And you feel like you've got, like, nothing. You feel like you have no power. Like you have no hope. Like you can't accomplish anything. That's actually the best place to be in, because then you ask God to do it, and he does. And then you get more fired up about what he gave you and what's inside of you. And what lives in you. He says, remain in me, and I will remain in you. God's an unconditional God, right? No, he's not. No, he's not. He's very conditional. He's very conditional. See, if you studied God's word and gotten the truth and gotten baptized for the forgiveness of your sins and the Holy Spirit lives in you, you've already got it. He ain't chasing you no more. He's not chasing you. He chased you your whole life to get you there.
Yeah.
Now it's your turn to chase him the rest of your life.
Yeah.
He's very clear. Like, if you don't remain in him, he will not remain in you. If you won't read your Bible, if you won't pray, he will not remain in you. He will leave you at some point. Because that's called apostasy. It's the unforgivable sin. You've got to. Now, okay, I didn't have a quiet time today. Oh my gosh. No, you're not going to hell because you didn't have a quiet time. It's not how it works. It's not how it works. It's staying in that place for a long time and your sins continually overcoming you because you're not feeding yourself the word of God, not doing the work of God, and then you get overtaken, and then you hate God because your life's so miserable.
Yeah.
That's how it works.
Come on, Ron.
That's right.
I mean, the Israelites complained for 40 years. That's a lot of patience. It's a lot of patience before he just finally let him have it.
Yeah.
And it wasn't his plan to do all of that with them. They chose their plan when they wouldn't let go of their fears.
Wow.
He said, "Will our women and children be taken as plunder? We're gonna die in the desert." They were not gonna die in the desert. But because they kept mocking him for 40 years, he goes, "Fine, die in the desert then." That's what he does in our life. If you won't be faithful, he will be faithful. We think that's not good. No, he'll be faithful with the fire of God coming down on us, and it will be fire and brimstone on the last day.
Wow.
That he is faithful, but he's very conditional. He was totally unconditional in chasing you down. How dare us try and make him chase us down again?
Wow.
I have the truth. I know you. I understand all things. Now find me. God's not doing that. He's not doing that anymore. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. You can't run around reading scriptures other people posted on Facebook and call it a quiet time and then expect you're going to live a powerful life.
Hey, keep it real, Ron.
You know?
Come on, Ron.
You can't get up on Sunday morning and have what I'm giving you right now be your quiet time and live a powerful life. You've got to have your own conviction and have your own time with God. If you don't read, you don't listen to God. See, a relationship is two ways, right? So I'm talking to Austin. Hey, Austin, what's up? Oh, he's talking back. Now we're having a relationship, right? That's how it goes. That's how it works, right? So if I'm praying all the time, I'm doing all the talking. If I won't read, I go talk to the hand. I don't want to hear what you have to say. I'll hear it from somebody else, third party. I'll hear it from my preacher, third party, and he knows what he's doing, so I'll just believe him. That's not a relationship with God.
Come on, bro.
And there's no power in that. There's only slow spiritual death from that. That makes all of us have to watch it. So, he says in verse 5 again, I am the vine, you are the branches. Now here's the cool part. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit.
Oh, yeah.
Here's the cool thing about it. You don't even have to try. When you're close to God, you don't have to try to bear fruit.
Yeah.
See, many of us are trying to bear fruit. I want to bear fruit. Well, I want to find somebody to come to church with me. Nobody will come with me because look at you. My leader said I got to get a visitor. Oh, my gosh. Oh, but that was a cool point. I like that. Yeah, bro. See, what are you doing?
Come on, Ron.
You serve the God that like consumed 850 false prophets. You serve the God who gave up his son for you. And why did he give up his son for you? So you would spend quality time with him. And if you do, you will bear much fruit. That's just how it works. You can't stop it, and you can't try and make it happen. It's just something that happens as a result of your time with God. That doesn't mean like try and like never talk to anybody and see if I can bear fruit. Because when you're close to God, you can't stop talking about it. So it just flows out in every conversation you have. I heard some sisters were going to hang out with somebody that walked away from the church and the person was like, I don't want to talk about God. Well, good luck. That's what's coming out of me, baby. I ain't shutting it up for you. It's just out of the overflow.
Come on, Ron.
But you've got to know what you've got.
Yeah.
You've got to know what God gave you. You've got to know what he's done for him. And you've got to be grateful for it.
Yeah.
That's the way it works. There's no shortcuts. There's no quick fix. There's no get-rich-quick scheme in the kingdom. There's no get fruitful quick schemes.
Yeah.
You spend time with God, you get grateful for what he's done, and you stand in awe of his word, and then everybody you talk to wants to come.
Yeah.
That's how it works. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Now, make sure you don't misunderstand this next part. Because there's the vine. He says, remain in me, right? So that means you're part of the vine, right? Not the branch. The branch gets cut off. Those are the areas of your life that keep you unfruitful. Those areas get cut off. That's called repentance.
Yeah.
Right? So he says, if anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch. See, he's not the branch. He's like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. So, when we don't repent of sin in our life, then we wither. We're like the branch. So we look like what got thrown out, even though we're right here. So that's the person that walks in and they're like, yeah, there he goes again. He likes hearing himself talk. Jeez. We're withering. We're withering because we're not in awe of God. You'll never be in awe of God's leaders and God's people if you're not in awe of God. All you'll see is their imperfection. You know why you're going to see their imperfection? They're not Jesus. Just want to help you out with that. Okay, I get the honor of leading the super region, and I'm fired up. I'm like, I love you guys. This is incredible. But I'm not your God, I'm not your Savior, and I'm not Jesus. I'll die for you. I'll give my life for you. But I'm not perfect. My thing's anger. I get angry, you know? So that doesn't produce the righteous life. And then when I do that, I'm not going to try and do it, but if I do it, you're going to have to forgive me. Because guess what? All the complaining and all the stuff, I have to forgive you. There you go. That's how it works. I can't just get angry and stay there. I got till the end of the day. Don't let the sun go down. I got to deal with it, you know? That's the scriptures. So how about that? You know, don't be like the branch. Cut the branch off so that you can be more fruitful. Let God's word that you're reading prune you and cut off everything that is unfruitful. He says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, check this out. This is a cool promise. Hashtag write this down. Ask whatever you wish and it will be given. Woo! This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Wow. Be faithful. Be faithful. An unfruitful disciple is an unfaithful disciple.
Come on, bro.
You go, wow, that's harsh. Why you got to go there? Because you can just decide right now, I'm faithful, if you've been unfaithful. It's that easy. Don't be down that you haven't been. Don't be angry that you're challenged if you've been. Just get faithful. If you haven't had a quiet time, first person, I'll give you my notes. Take it. Go read it. Study it. Have a quiet time afterwards. See, that's if you drop the ball, guess where the ball is? Right there. Pick it up. Woo! God gave me a ball. I'm fired up. You just pick that sucker up and run for a touchdown. Like that. That's how we do it.
Come on, bro.
Here's the thing, like, you're a disciple of Jesus, right?
Yeah. Come on.
If I plant an apple seed in the ground, what's going to grow? Apple tree. Wow, isn't that amazing? Like, God's so complex, isn't he? So, it's amazing. We read the Bible and we see what the disciples do, and then we go, oh, I don't need to do that. Wow. Yet, when you bring somebody to church and study the Bible with them, guess what they're going to say? I don't need to do that, and they're not a disciple. For them, they're not a disciple because they don't, because you just let them astray. Yeah. No. You've got to be the disciple that you want to make. Yeah, be the disciple you want to make. See, here's the thing, like, you don't like your group? Change it. Don't leave it. Change it. How do you change it? Look in the mirror. Look in the mirror. So, because here's the thing. You multiply yourself. This is something that happens automatically. See, the bearing of fruit is something that just happens. It happens automatically. You make more of you. So if you're a complainer, everybody in your group's going to be complaining eventually. They'll either deal with you or you'll influence them. There's no in between. So if you want the complaining to stop in your group and you want the spirit to be lifted up, stop complaining. Then the person you meet will come in and guess what? They'll be so grateful and they'll never complain because they don't hear complaining. So you make the kind of disciples that you are. So if you keep baptizing people and they keep falling away, it's because you need to choose to be faithful. And so we've got to get faithful in the Lord and stay connected to the vine. You know, this promise of whatever you want is so cool. What is it that you want? Now, here's the catch, right? Because we're kind of manipulative in our nature, right? If what you want isn't what God wants, then he's going to say no. See, he's saying that to people. He's saying, remain in the vine, right? Remain in me. So if you're with God, you want what God wants. See how that works right there? So when you're not remaining in God, what you want is not what God wants. So he won't give it to you. God forbid he does, because if he does, wow, you're in trouble. Wow, because then you got what you wanted that wasn't godly. Ever gotten that? That's like getting immorality, right? That's like getting even when somebody hurts you and you get back. See, sometimes God lets you have what you want. Then you go, wow, I shouldn't have wanted that.
Come on, bro.
But this thing about getting what you want is so cool. What is it that God wants that you want also? You know, it's funny. At the beginning of the year, you know, we give these bulletins out every year. And the first one was our goals for the year. Year of the impossible. Has God answered your impossible prayer yet? Anybody have God answer an impossible prayer so far? Oh, wow. Okay. All right. Let's go right here. What did he answer? Yeah. You get to see your kids more often. Now, that is awesome. Now, here's the new thing, right? We started this at staff. So we got hashtag fire, right? So every time you hear fire from the Lord like that, you're going to hashtag it and put it on the internet. You're going to put your impossible prayers up there. Now, at staff, what we started doing is that's fire. So he gets to see his kids more often. What's that called? That's fire! Jermaine, what's yours?
Mine's, I put down I wanted to be a house church leader, just so, you know, I would just...
Really? I didn't know that. I guess I did know that, but I didn't know that.
A couple weeks later, that's when y'all told me I'm gonna be a house church.
How about that? Dang. Now, here we go. Jermaine's a house church leader. That's fire. Wow. You got to baptize your sister? Oh, my gosh. That's fire. Wow. Ariel Hall. And he came to church. Amen. Her kid's father came to church. Fire. Amen. I can't do this all day, but here's the thing. My son had an impossible prayer.
My impossible prayer for this year is for my brother to be restored, and he's out here in church.
Dylan and I have had the impossible prayer this year that my son Devin, who got baptized last year and fell away, would come back to the Lord. And yesterday he went to CR, and Princeton picked him up, took him to CR, and he came home and he told my wife, I'm getting restored to the Lord. So, come on. So when you see him, encourage him, you know. And those of you who are visiting, my son, you know, he got meningitis as a baby and got brain damage. And so he gets a lot of anxiety. So crowds are really hard. So he was here for the first half of the service. He has to walk out to deal with his anxiety and stuff. You'll see him. He's the big 6'2", big curly hair. So just give him a hug. I'm so proud of him that he's coming back to the Lord. So amen. Amen. Now I'm crying and cracking and everything, you know, because fire from the Lord makes you cry, you know? How about that? Point number two, get radical.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah.
We're going to stay in John 15 here, but go to verse 16.
Come on, Ron.
I want to ask you today, just like Moses, just like Gideon, I can say with great confidence, not one of you yet has become all that God has called you to be. You were created to be so much more than you are right now. And it doesn't mean that you're bad and you haven't done what you're supposed to do. But today I want it to be the day that you get in touch with who God created you to be. Some of you were created to be evangelists. Some of you were created to be pastors, teachers, head ushers, sound guys, whatever it is. God created you to do more than you're doing right now. Not because you're trying harder, because you're getting closer to Him. And He's honoring your work more and more. And so right here in John 15, verse 16, the Bible says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command, love each other." We are so blessed to be in the presence of people who love God. And not just people that come and spend all their time with great music and putting on this incredible sounding worship, but give their whole lives to God. Give their whole hearts to God. And yes, use their talents and have some really cranking songs and things in worship consistently. But there's no place on earth like the kingdom of God. That's so diverse. I mean, we look around the room. You got black people, white people, Asian people, poor people, rich people, all in harmony with each other. Yeah. Even many of you that were not in harmony when you came in right now are getting in harmony. You know what I mean? Because you're seeing the goodness of God. You're seeing the fire of God.
Yeah.
And how it burns up all in us that's not good. So that we can be a pure, holy people for Him. The article is about making vows to God. I want you to make a vow that you're going to give the rest of this year to being who you need to be, who He called you to be. That you're going to climb out of your wine press, that you'll thresh wheat where you're supposed to thresh wheat, that you'll make some great wine that you'll drink with your friends and family. And yet it takes making vows to God. As a leadership, we make vows, right? So we have, if you look at the back of the bulletin, our Crown of Thorns project. What have we vowed to God? We vowed to God that we will evangelize all the nations in our generation. We vowed that we would honor this command from the scriptures for every generation to evangelize their generation, that we will do ours. I will not leave part of the evangelization of the world for my son to do his generation and mine. We vow to God that we will do this. We know it's God's will that we should do this. And it takes everything we have to make it happen. And so we make this vow to God, which means we understand I give my time, my heart, my money, whatever it takes for that to happen. And so we vow to get to Hong Kong this year in 2017. And yet if you pray through the Crown of Thorns project, you see the other cities that we're vowing to go to. Now sometimes God just kind of changes things up. And we say, okay, we're going to Cairo, Egypt, but we're in Lagos, Nigeria instead. You know, that's just kind of how it works sometimes. Why? The Nigerian man, like the Macedonian man, said, "Hey, I'm going to travel through three countries, come to your conference, and I have a whole church of people in Lagos waiting for you. Please come and save us." Amen. So that's why we're in Lagos. But some people go, "Oh, you don't know what you're doing. You changed the plan." We made a vow that we're going to evangelize the world, which means we respond to those who call and cry out to be saved. Now, I updated the Crown of Thorns project last night before we printed these to the latest version of it. And what's really cool is in phase three, we got Monterey that went from red needing to be planted to green because it was planted at the Mexico City conference. And then we also have Birmingham that was sent out in England. And there, that church is cranking away. And I want to call you to pray for these cities. You can't follow a plan when you don't know the plan. And yet we vowed to this plan. That's why oftentimes we're pushing and pushing and pushing to make it happen. And you're like, why are you keep pushing? Because it's got to get done before I die. But you're asking for all my money. Yes, I am. I don't want some of it. I want all of it. And the people on the internet are going to post that I just said that. And they'll cut it all out to just, I want all of it. If we took every dime in every account, banking, retirement, if we sold every home, it's only a couple in the movie. But if we extracted every single penny of every resource we had, it would not save this world. Then we go, why are we always asking for so much money? Because there already isn't enough. You gonna say no? I mean, look at here. Cebu, Philippines, 2017. You gonna tell all those Filipinos, no, we're not coming? Because I don't have time to go out and raise money? I have it, but I'm using it for Starbucks. I like my Starbucks more than I care about your salvation. I mean, let's keep it real, right? See, I can preach it because I gave up everything. You think I have a savings account? You think I got some hidden offshore account somewhere? I got bills is what I got. And lots of them, right? See, I put it all on the line. And even some of it I put on the line with my own strength, and I got a little bit of debt from it. And that was stupid. And don't do that. But hey, I made a choice, and it was my strength, not enough prayer. Forgive me for wanting to save the world. You know what I mean? And I'm paying that debt down, and it'll be gone this year.
Amen.
And so, but if I'm going to go in debt, I'd rather have it be saving the world than for filling my house with stuff. But these are people. These are not cities. These are cities filled with people. And they need you. They need some of you to go, and they need some of you to give. Actually, they need all of us to give.
That's right.
Come on, bro.
When Aaron... sons brought unauthorized fire, what did God do? He burned them up. So why do we worry about, oh, is the money being spent right? What do you think God's going to do to somebody that's spending it wrong?
Come on.
Burn them up. Gone. Problem solved. See, it's actually that we're selfish. It's actually that we're greedy in America. We struggle with greed.
Yeah, that's right.
And so put it all on the line. All my eggs are in one basket. So follow my example. Except the debt part. Don't do that. Don't do that part. That was dumb. But put your whole heart to saving this world. Stop letting people walk by you on the street. Have a heart that understands you're saved already. And give. Stop messing around with these attitudes with people. See, it's time to get radical. It's time to go crazy. So... go to 2 Thessalonians 1. We'll close out with this scripture. 2 Thessalonians 1.
Awesome, bro. Come on, bro.
See, I don't want it to be hype when I'm talking about getting radical. You notice I kind of brought the tone down a little bit? Because this is a radical that cannot be a fake, rah-rah radical.
Yeah, yeah.
This has got to be a I get it radical. You know what I'm saying? 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 5. All this is evidence. What? Everything. Creation of the earth. Everything that's happened in your life. All the times God stepped in and saved you. All this is evidence that God's judgment is right. And as a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. Well, here it goes right there. If you ain't suffering, what does that mean? See, you've got to respond to God's word the way God's word calls you to respond. See, we go after saving this world in a way that it causes suffering for ourselves. It's a sacrifice. We go to bed tired. We go to bed strained. And yet, we sleep like babies when we do that. Oh, the sleep is so sweet. It says, God is just. Now we're going to get off the judgment part on you. Check this out. He will pay back trouble to those who trouble you and give relief to you who are troubled and to us as well. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. He will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and the majesty of his power on the day he comes to be glorified in his holy people and to be marveled at among all those who believed. Now here it comes. This includes you. Because you believed our testimony to you. With all these vows that we're making and all these things that are happening, I want to bring your attention to the center of the bulletin. Because we're, you know, Hong Kong's going to be done. Hopefully you put your 25% in today. I put 50% in. I'm halfway done. I don't want to wait until May. I just want to get it done. I just want to get it done and focus on saving the city. And yet, once the Crown of Thorns project, phase one is done, that's when each Crown of Thorns city focuses on their own areas. What world sector are we in? The one in the United States. So this is our plan that we hyper-focus on now. And we have a plan called Operation Eagle. Right now, we have churches in 15 states. 35 to go. Anybody, who, raise your hand if your family members that are not saved live in the United States. Right? This plan is to reach your family. It's to reach your family, their friends, and their friends, and their friends, and everybody's friends. And yet I want to close this out with Nehemiah 4:14. Remember the Lord, who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, fight for your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your homes. Today, be faithful to God. Get radical in your evangelism. Build the altar of your ministry. Pray for the sacrifice. Bring the fire of the Lord down, and we will be able to post #fire. Be faithful in radical evangelism. Get your impossible prayer, and then we can all say together, what? That's fine. I love you guys. Have a great day.